Oh hey, this is Matt Fetcher from AudioKit. Let's get started.
What is up, YouTube? Today I have an awesome interview with David Gibson from Futurisonic. He's an AUV3 plugin developer and all-around good guy. We're gonna talk about all kinds of things, so let's get started.
I am here with David Gibson from Futurisonic. They're an awesome app company in the UK. They make incredible AUV plugins such as FS Reverser Delay, FS Freeze Verb, and their newest one is FS Refactor. For those watching, getting into iOS music making, do you want to explain what AUV3 is?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so AUV3, or the audio unit, is a sort of format that's been around for quite a long time. Initially on desktop, it's been around for a long time, and it was really Apple's alternative to VST. So it's a plug-in format to allow you to process audio or to act as new kind of synthesizers and so on. So we made it over to iOS in 2015. And before that time, we had kind of InterApp Audio and Audio Bus, which has allowed us to connect different audio apps together and kind of use and perform with them together. But audio units were a big step forward because it meant that we could now load our audio units into another host, which had been the standard on desktop for a long time. And there's some clear advantages in doing this. So they work directly with the host, so you don't have to keep on changing apps all the time. And we can have multiple instances of the audio unit, and in particularly in the case of effects, this is really kind of crucial. The parameter names can be read directly by the host rather than dealing with MIDI directly and so on. And there's a few other benefits around preset loading and saving and so on. So it's really, in our opinion anyway, kind of the future for iOS music.
And for the people watching, when he says host, he means apps like GarageBand, Cubasis, BeatMaker 3. So basically a DAW for your iPad. You can do everything in the box in the iPad. And his apps work as effects within those DAWs.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so there's a number of different hosts, and as long as they support that AUV3 format, then you'll be able to load our effects as well as other people's effects and instruments and so on.
That's awesome. So what drew you to audio apps? Because you've been making apps for a long time.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, my background is in music technology. So I have been in music technology for a long time. I was a sound engineer for the BBC for 5 years or so. I was a teacher of music technology. I used to write for a number of different music tech magazines. I've been sort of in that field for a while, and I guess I'd always been on the kind of more technology end as opposed to the music end. So it was a natural fit then to continue with software development. I had always worked quite closely with software like Max MSP and Reactor, which is kind of almost like a visual programming language anyway. So it was a natural fit.
Awesome. That's incredible. It's quite a resume there.
Nice, thanks.
AUV3 is such a hot topic right now. Everyone wants AUV3 everything when it comes to apps. So for developers looking to get into it, what advice do you have for them to learn?
Yeah, I mean, it's a long road. That's definitely something to be said. I mean, like all audio programming really on iOS and on desktop. With our work on kind of core audio, there's not a huge amount of documentation from Apple's side as maybe you would expect, particularly in comparison to, you know, kind of frameworks like UIKit and so on, which are really heavily documented. So you're really relying on the community as well to kind of get that help. But for somebody going into it, I guess really just understanding that, you know, there's lots of different parts to this. You've got the programming side, absolutely. You've got the DSP, so the audio signal processing side. You've got the design, the UX, and so on. So there's quite a lot to learn, particularly if you're going about it as an individual. But for somebody starting off and just wanting to get into it now, I'd say definitely make sure you've got a really strong grasp of Swift and Objective-C at this point. And at the same time, you want to be learning audio signal processing. So as I mentioned before, programs like Max MSP or Native Instruments Reactor, These are kind of visual programming environments which are good to learn on. Or similarly, there's Audulous, which we have on iPad, which is a kind of modular studio, if you like, which can really help you get to grips with that lower level side of signal processing, which is what you'll need. And then once you've got these and you've got an understanding of these, then, you know, learn C++. You're going to have to use it, and learn some of the, you know, kind of more advanced stuff around pointers and memory management and so on, because that's really going to help. But again, another great way to learn it is, you know, to get in there and start playing with AudioKit and start looking about, you know, developing the framework, because as I said before, you know, with all audio programming, the documentation is usually pretty thin, but the AudioKit's got this great Slack group, and people are more than happy to help and help you get there. And because AudioKit's, you know, designed in such a way, the audio engine's already there, you know, you can just focus on building your custom effects and sort of trying them out and seeing how your ideas work without going through this whole, you know, the whole long journey that's usually required.
Yeah, and so that brings up a good point, because you're a pretty busy guy. You know, you've got apps in the App Store, you're doing a full client load. And so you also give back with open source. And so why do you think it's important to contribute back to open source, and what's your motivation for that?
I think it's absolutely important. I mean, you know, really, as developers, the way that we progress and kind of move forward is through shared knowledge. You know, everyone who's been a developer for any reasonable amount of time will be more than aware of Stack Overflow. You know, it's through these communities that we can you know, we can progress as individuals, but also we can push the sort of technology forward as well. I mean, for us, it's, you know, it's kind of a no-brainer, really, because we want to give back to the community. Obviously, like I say, as developers, we've all taken from the community. We've all built applications that use open source frameworks. We've built, you know, client work using AudioKit and so on. And similarly with the amazing audio engine before that. It's not even a question to consider for us. You know, we need it there, and we use it in our work. So it's, you know, we're more than happy to give that back to the community as well, and continue the development on the framework, whether it's something directly that we've done on the client project or whether it's, you know, just something that we want to work on, such as the offline processing and so on.
That's such an admirable quality. And, you know, that's, you know, how we can all elevate ourselves as developers, you know. Dave, do you want to tell us a little bit about Futursonic?
Yeah, sure. So, we're a software development company based here in Bristol in the southwest of the UK. The history of the company goes back quite a long way, all the way back to kind of 2008, 2009. So it started us as Bang Means Do It Software, which some eagle-eye folks will have noticed that's still the name on the App Store. Early on in those days, we released an app called MicroTrackDB, which was all the way back in 2009. We released it on a platform called Samsung Beta, which doesn't exist anymore, but was quite big in Europe at the time. So we released that app. It had good traction. It was kind of like a 808, 909, 303 emulator. And following that, we released it then on iOS in around 2011. From that point, really, the company's continued to grow. We worked for a time on a number of music apps, but also on various other apps, Wall Street Journal, Audi, London's Air Ambulance, and so on. And in December last year, we launched Futursonic, which was with the intention to really focus on all the audio work that we were doing. So, you know, we got this view to create audio software for iOS, and at least initially we've been focusing on AUV3 effects. For the future, we'll continue to release audio software, more AUV3 effects, but possibly some other standalone software as well, and to continue working with our clients in the audio and music sector. You know, we want to be quite active in being a part of growing just iPad music and iOS music as a you know, as a field in general, and getting people interested and getting people involved and, you know, teaching people how you go about this stuff. So it's not just a kind of portable desktop device or a laptop device. It's, you know, it's an interface in its own right. And I think in a way it's worth, you know, the way that users use these devices, it's worth reconsidering how we make music software and what's right for the iPad rather than just what has been right previously and porting that over. So yeah, it's exciting times for iOS music as a whole, but also exciting times for just music in general and how portable devices might change the way that people use music. And we're fully on board with that and, you know, embracing that.
Yeah, it's, you know, I'm really glad there's people like you who are kind of pushing the envelope and making new things with AUV3. Okay, so tell us a little bit about the inspiration for your newest plugin.
Yeah, absolutely. So as discussed previously, you know, our focus has been on kind of AUV3 effects, and we really wanted to build something this time around that was like really creative, really good sort of sound design tool for people out there. So my, you know, in my experience of using the iPad for music production, it's great, I love it, but I feel one of the areas that is really missing at the moment is you know, we've got great mixing plugins now. You know, we've got great other tools for kind of crafting sound and whatnot, but whilst there are a few examples out there already, particularly some of the stuff that Audio Damage is doing, you know, I feel like the sound design tools, there's a lot more space for some really interesting stuff there. So we wanted to build something in that vein. So our newest plugin, FS Refractor, it takes a kind of unique approach on a kind of flange delay effect. To say that kind of narrows it down quite a lot, because in essence, it's kind of like a sequenced effects unit. And with this effect, it's really flexible in terms of the output that you can get. So as a few examples, you can, you know, feed kind of a beat into the effect and create a bass line just from that beat. No other, you know, no MIDI, no, nothing like that, just through the sequenced effect. You can take sort of a held pad sound and have it create an arpeggio from that sound. So yeah, it's really flexible, and lots more you can do. Wild delay effects, all kinds of sort of motion and modulation and movement through your sound. So yeah, exciting to see how it's received.
Yeah, it's you know, for those watching, I had a chance to check it out in the beta, and it's a lot of fun. You know, At first, I wasn't sure what it did, so I just started twisting knobs, and you can instantly make sounds even if you don't know what you're doing, like myself. So it's a great creative tool.
Yeah, superb. Yeah, that's good to hear. And this is the first time I'm actually hearing this feedback as well. So this is this is really good to hear. But I think with this effect as well, you know, it's very hands on. You know, it's very much just get in there and just start, you know, experimenting and finding what it is, because there are kind of a few sort of traditional ways to use this effect, if you like, and it can do all those classic sort of flange sounds that you're used to hearing, but it can do so much more beyond that, and it's really worth just, you know, firing different source material into it and seeing what happens.
So a lot of people watching, they want to make the first music app. What kind of advice do you have for people looking to get started into music app development?
Sure. I think first of all, just, you know, get in there with AudioKit, you know, download it and start going through the examples and things and the playgrounds, and just start getting to grips, because it really is like the quickest way that you're going to do this. And it's really amazing what, you know, what has been done with AudioKit in terms of the playgrounds, because it you know, you can get started in, you know, 10 minutes and you're away, you're building your own stuff already. So I think that would be the first place to start. And once you've got a good you know, grasp of that, start building out an application of your own. And then when you're ready, make the move into perhaps, you know, building a simple custom effect for AudioKit, whether that's, you know, something that you keep to yourself or share to the community. You know, either way, I think that's a really good step then. There's a very nice path, if you like, for you to progress to that stage, which wasn't available previously. So, yeah, new developers should definitely, you know, grasp that with both hands, because it was a lot more difficult a few years ago. So, And then progress from there, then start looking at AV Audio Engine, start looking at the Apple's example for, you know, building audio units, and go from there.
That's really great advice. And for those watching, I didn't tell him to plug AudioKit at all. He did that on his own.
Absolutely not. No. It's been great for us. And like I said, join the Slack channel. That's the other thing. Straight away. Don't wait. Get straight in there, because everyone's really friendly and helpful. And, it's a really active channel. So, you'll find lots of great advice there as well. If you're a developer at the moment who's looking to get started and start releasing your own apps, the temptation is for the first app that you release to be everything. So you'll spend, 5 years on it, and we're constantly tweaking and doing all this stuff. It's an easy trap to fall into, but it's far better to focus on getting a basic first version of the product and getting it out there and see how people react to it. And also there's a process to learn. There's a process of submitting the app to the App Store, dealing with the Apple review process and what that entails. So, it's not just about developing the app. There's all these other things. And then once the app's out there, it's marketing and getting the word out there to people, the people who will be interested, which is as much of a challenge in itself. So, that would be my advice.
So you're an experienced developer. What are some things you wish you knew when you started that you know now that you could share with other developers?
Sure. Okay. I think one of the things I would say is get to grips with Git early on, and sort of source control and things, because that's really kind of vital, in kind of this day and age with programming, and particularly if you want to work with other developers and teams. And once you get that, you're opening up a whole world of kind of open source communities that you can join and be a part of, and do work with, find opportunities to work with other developers, whether that's working on open source frameworks or if you're getting a job at a company or an agency, that will really bring that's one way to really progress your skills as a developer quickly. I think that's probably, my best advice, and just always be interested, always be looking to, kind of progress yourself. I guess the worst thing you can do is just sort of get stuck of doing the same thing over and over again. Be inquisitive. And if you read or see or hear someone say or talk about something that you're not aware of, then go and find out straight away. All the information's out there. It's just a search away. So I think as long as you're always inquisitive, you'll always keep on progressing.
That is really great advice. For those watching, development is a lifelong learning process.
It's a great, what I can say as well, it's a great field to be in. I mean, the one thing with mobile in terms of business as well, it's still really kind of young and exciting and fresh, and people are still there's a lot of interest around mobile, and people are still at that point where they're trying out new things, experimenting. There's new technology, the technology is moving so quickly that you'll do lots of exciting work in this field.
Yeah, and the amazing thing about mobile development, it's something that one or two people can push out an app by themselves, and they don't need a team of 100 people.
Absolutely, yeah. Well, the very first app that I released, MicroTrack DB, all the way back then, I had never worked as a professional developer at that point. And I released this app, and it was really successful on the Samsung Bada platform, and got a lot of interest, because at that time there was nothing else out there that was like it. So that was a really fun journey to be on as well, yeah. But you're right, I mean, it's not like, it's not like the old days where you need, £100,000 minimum to even get started. You can just, get that Apple developer license and just start putting stuff out there. And really, there's no, there's nothing stopping you from doing that. If that's what you want to do, build a basic app and get it out there and see how people react and start learning the process.
So you also do client work. Do you want to tell us a little bit about that and any advice for developers looking to get into doing some freelance work on the side?
Yeah, in terms of the clients that we work with, you know, we've got a really good relationship with Brap, which is like a social network for kind of urban music producers and performers to record music videos, collaborate, promote their music, and so on. And there's we have a few other clients, not allowed to speak about all of them publicly, but we have kind of like a live performance door that we work on for a kind of leading music tech company in the Christian music space. And there's another app that we've just finished work on recently, which is like a performance and music video recording platform for rap and urban music. And then we do some work that's audio, but not necessarily music related. So we've done a considerable amount of work for Rokercom, which is like a secure voice over IP application like Skype.
Awesome.
And of course, the work that we do on AudioKit as well.
So do you feel like it's important for developers to get into other work besides their own apps just so they can learn more and have experience with other different technologies?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's necessarily vital. If all you want to do is just, you know, you build the kind of ideas you've got for audio apps in your head, I mean, that's fine as well. But what I will say is that by doing that work, you know, you learn a lot. As you know, as I'm sure you're aware, and most developers out there will, you know, agree that, you know, it's such a huge field, and every developer's got their own bits of experience and you know, brings what they do to the table. So by doing this work, you'll work with a lot more people, you'll gain different bits of experience from elsewhere, and it will just make you a more rounded, more professional developer overall. You know, like I say, not that there's anything wrong with just focusing on kind of doing your own thing, and that's great as well. But there's definitely a lot to be said for being able to build that experience and knowledge as well.
Awesome. Well, that concludes this episode, and I'd encourage everyone to visit futuresonic.io, check out their blog and their awesome apps.
This has been Matthew Fetcher. Thanks for watching.
You can learn more about getting started with AudioKit at audiokitpro.com. I'll see you soon.